a professor who was teaching New Testament, as he approached Revelation, said to his class, very frankly, "We're not going to study Revelation because it is symbolic. All we know is that Jesus Christ is coming back." With anxiety, a student raised his hand and said, "I'm confused. Is Jesus coming back or not?" I gave you two quotes, you'll see, from George Mueller. Just in case you didn't get that joke, maybe it's tired, or maybe it just wasn't funny, I'm not really quite sure which one, but something that I have seen in my studies of Revelation, which you will see as well, is that those who refuse to take time to seek after the truths that God has revealed in Revelation will always use the word symbolic. And so you have two themes in Revelation. You have, is it literal? Is it actually going to happen? Or is it symbolic? And who says which is which? I want to challenge you with the same challenge that I have given myself, that God has really laid on my heart, that you will exhaust every literal interpretation so that you can say, as Moses did in Deuteronomy 29:29, the secret things belong to the Lord. But God has given us this book because it is profitable for us. George Mueller, just finished reading a biography on him, gave up so much for the kingdom of God, opened up over three orphanages, took care of the homeless children, gave of his time, gave of his wealth. At the age of 70, he actually became a missionary. People at age 70 want to retire, as though there's retiring from being a herald. Herald didn't get to choose what he said. He just said what the king had entrusted to him. George Mueller was the same one who said, "I never made a sacrifice." This is what he says. He says, "When the day of recompense comes, our only regret will be that we have done, it's not that we have done so little for him, not that we have done too much." John Bunyan in Pilgrim's Progress, I want to keep you, remind you that he's in prison. John Bunyan was in prison for over a decade. He actually had a family. He was allowed to be released from prison earlier, but he chose to stay because there was a ministry in the prison. This is what he says. It's in prison. "At the day of doom, men shall be judged according to their fruits. It will not be said, 'Did you believe?' But were you doers or talkers only?" This is a man who was in prison for the gospel of Jesus Christ. The author is, as our brothers have communicated already, it is the Holy Spirit. Some try to discredit the Bible. The reality is we don't really need to know an author. The author of Job is not specifically mentioned. The author of Hebrews is not specifically mentioned. But the Spirit of the Lord has, in God's sovereignty, he has included this book in for us, so which means that we cannot use the pun, "It is symbolic," because as we'll see in our study, I pray to God, certain things in here is not symbolic. Jesus is going to judge the righteous and the wicked. I hope that is literal. And so John is the apostle. He was the one of the sons of thunder. His brother James, as our brother had already mentioned, he is the son of Zebedee. He was executed. His head was chopped off. His head was placed on a block, and his head fell off in 44 AD. John was alive the whole time, as every apostle was martyred. He's the only one still alive. Some internal evidences for those of you guys who are taking notes. John is the author of 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, the Gospel according to John, and as we'll see here in Revelation. And one of the reasons why is because there are internal evidences, okay? There's internal evidences in terms of the structure of this letter. So for example, the word is mentioned in all five letters. Overcome is mentioned in all five letters. As a matter of fact, a total of 19 times. True is mentioned 8 times in the Gospel of John, 7 times in the Epistle of John, and 17 times in Revelation. And Lamb is mentioned once in the Gospel of John and 28 times in Revelation. In terms of the date, I provided a very loose date. For those of you who hold to a particular eschatology, which we'll get to, I have to teach this as best as I can, and I hope you are unable to kind of digest what position I take, but I have a feeling after I start talking, you'll know where I am. Some place as early as 70 when the temple was sacked. We're going to see, as I show you, I think that that's false. I personally would render towards mid to late 90s AD writing, but it doesn't really matter. Purpose is stated in Revelation chapter 1, verse 2, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants the things that must soon take place. He made it known by sending his angel to a servant, John, who testifies to everything he saw. That is the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. This revelation, Brother Joe, earlier, he said that all of God's story or the Bible of his story can be divided into three categories: creation, decreation, and recreation. Another approach towards that is creation, fall, redemption, and consummation. So this is going to be the recreation or the consummation. Themes is the sovereignty of God over the affairs of the universe. My prayer is that, especially as we look at the number of martyrs, that you will gain an appreciation towards the sovereignty of God. Listen, not as an abstract idea like God is sovereign, more like in your life, yeah, he is sovereign. And those of you guys who have experienced God's faithfulness in your life, I heard one pastor say, if you can explain how it happened, it wasn't God, okay? And I think oftentimes that's what it's like for us. But the sovereignty of God over all of the affairs in the universe, including people who are evil and wicked towards you. God's justice, his power, his mercy, and grace towards sinners in this age, and Christ's victory over Satan, demons, including eternal rewards and eternal punishments. I included here a couple of the early church fathers, some of them you're familiar with. This is not a session on how did we get the scriptures, maybe that's for next time, but it is reassuring to know that the early church fathers acknowledged and recognized even Revelation, which was the last book written. God in his sovereignty had communicated that. Man did not decide what was God's written word, but man acknowledged what was God's written word. Amen. And so in terms of methods of interpretation, there's technically five. I include a sixth. You're going to see a similar pattern. Let's look at the first one. There's one that's historical or background. We want to know what was the meaning of the book when it was written, what was the immediate context, and who it was written to. We know that this letter was written to the early church. Revelation chapters 2 through 3, as we're going to examine just briefly. There are going to be 7 churches. These are literal churches, okay? There is persecution going on, as our brothers had already mentioned. And this message was mostly towards the Christians in the first half, in the first half of the first century, and is a little bit applicable to us. So most of that stuff's already been taken care of, but we can kind of glean a little bit on. That's the historical background, okay? Second is futurist. Chapters 4 through 19 occur prior to the coming of Christ because it's the future, and chapter 20 and 21 is the judgment and the final state. Again, keep in mind, both 1 and 2 take a literal interpretation. Either literal in the immediate context, but it has happened. Continuous historical. This book is more symbolic than literal. It focuses on the abuses of especially the Catholic Church, and even those who partook of the Reformation. Preterist, pre, before, past, complete, a book was written, fulfilled. Doesn't really profit us little. Philosophical, symbolic, that's similar to continuous historical. That was the one that could have been included. I just didn't want to have a bunch of slashes and dashes and parentheses, so I gave you a separate one. And number 6 is the idealist. This book does not deal with any particular historical situation. Here's just a principle. There are principles that we can glean from this. Now, my time with you is a little bit different from the others who have shared because they had more than one book, and I have one. And there are many churches that are gathered here today, and I would just like to spend a couple minutes just as a jet tour, examining what was going on in the early churches, and do we see any of that going on today in ours? My prayer is that this was very, very convicting for me as I was studying these churches, because I'm going to tell you, if you are not part of a local congregation, you need to be obedient to Scripture and get in one. As the author of Hebrews says, do not neglect to meet together as some do. And if you are part of a congregation, you're going to see some similar themes. And I pray that it is for the affirmation and not for the appeal. So if you're wondering why there's a bunch of blanks, I just wanted you to pay attention to me and not drift off. So this is what Paul calls the labor of love. So I hope you embrace it as that. I also gave you an outline as well. I'm not going to go through the outline. Like I said, I would like to take time and make this very practical to us. Now, in terms of the context, John is in the island of Patmos. Okay, Patmos is a rocky island. What was he doing there? It was similar almost to like a Siberian concentration camp. Okay, they didn't just send him there and leave him there, but he would be picking up stones and dropping them and moving them, but he was allowed visitors. Okay, this is one of the reasons why these literal historical churches were actually able to receive this letter. So he was exiled there. Listen, these are literal churches, and none of them exist today. So you better take heed to what I say, or what God in His sovereignty has said to you, because if you don't, as we'll see, He will remove your lampstand from you. These real churches represent real affirmations, real appeals, and 5 of these churches have a mixture of what they're doing good and what they're not doing so well and what they need to work on, but 2 of them receive 0 appeals. So my prayer is that this would be an encouragement to you, but also a convicting, because I know for me, as I was studying this, I was examining our local body to see where we lay up in light of Scripture. So the church in Ephesus, it's located in Asia Minor. We know that Paul spent 3 years there. Ephesus is first influenced by Aquila and Priscilla, as well as Apollos. You remember Aquila and Priscilla? Taught Apollos the gospel, because all Apollos knew was the baptism of John the Baptist. He was a little bit out of the loop. I love how loving they pulled him to the side and they're like, yo, you gotta kind of watch what you're saying. Right? Could have blew up his spot, but love protects, right? So Paul arrived there. He spent 3 years there. His letter to the Ephesians was actually one of his prison epistles. It was one of 4 that was written. He left and he established his beloved child in the faith, Timothy, there. John apparently was also an elder in this church. And he was arrested. He was exiled by Domitian to Patmos. Patmos is about 60 miles away from Ephesus. Now, Ephesus had a history of what we like to call beasts of the faith. They had Apollos, they had Paul, they had Timothy, they had John. Their heritage was there. But as we'll see, they lost something. Just as a side note, within the city of Ephesus, there was one of the seven ancient wonders of the world. It's known as the Shrine of Diana. Now, Ephesus is a pagan city. You can read about it in Acts chapter 19. But Diana is also known as Artemis. Now, this is really interesting. Ready? So Artemis was a Greek god, and Diana was a Roman god. Now, check it out. Ready? So people who would come into Ephesus that was not familiar with which god was which was like, well, this god is a male or a female. It doesn't really matter. Do you think same sex gender question is a new issue? It actually even began during this time. This temple to the layperson was Diana or Artemis. It didn't really matter. It was a pagan god. The confusion of sexual identities is nothing new. It has been happening for over 2,000 years. We may see the fruit of it, but the seed has been here. This is Satan's first initiation, first attempt to confuse the design of God. He created male and female. And apparently this shrine, Diana or Artemis, resembled some type of buffalo or cow. And I'm looking around the room, making sure there's no one too young here. Okay, good. Apparently in this shrine, there were thousands of prostitutes who would offer sexual favors to all of the gods and everybody who entered the table. And so within this city, there was this church of Ephesus. Now, doctrinally, listen, doctrinally, they were strong. Look at their heritage. We just mentioned it. They labored. They did not tolerate sin. We'll see here, they persevered. Verse 3, I know you are enduring patiently. The Greek word is hupomone, okay? That word refers to an under-rower of a ship, okay? So you got these huge galley ships, right? At the top, you got the captain barking orders, right? And then below that, you got the sailors hoisting sail. But then underneath where that cold, leaking ship is, you have the under-rowers that pretty much are unknown. And so these people, those were people who worked, okay? They had people like that, but they were known. So they worked. They had a holy standard. They had discernment, and we also see that they tested every doctrine. They were doctrinally sound. And they even tested those who would regularly meet. The Nicolaitans are mentioned. You can read about it in Acts chapter 6. There was a deacon named Nicholas. We're not sure if this was a byproduct of him. Could be. But there was some heresy going on. And they checked him. They made sure that anybody who came in was doctrinally sound. So what did Jesus have against them? They left their first love. Now, if we do take a later date for this, it could have been in the early to mid-90s, okay, when Paul wrote Ephesians, this would have been anywhere between 59 to 62 AD. Okay, so there's two or three generations that have gone by. The original founders had implemented this systematic belief that knowledge took first precedence over people. Jesus is saying, I need you to remember what it was like on our honeymoon. So those of you guys who are saved in here, I want you to think back to your honeymoon with Jesus Christ when you were in love with him. When you wanted nothing but him, you were zealous, you didn't care who you told, and you didn't know nearly as much as you did now. You didn't even care. It's all about Jesus. People might ask me questions, but I got Jesus, so that's all that matters, right? Listen, their doctrine replaced their love towards God. I never, ever want my studies, my eschatology, my Christology, my knowledge to ever replace the people who it was meant for in the first place. Essentially, they were a bunch of systematic theology books going around with no labor towards people. They boasted in their theological studies, their heritage, their tradition. They became lovers of doctrine, not the doctrine giver. So Jesus says, you need to repent, for I will take your lampstand from you. Just to let you know, the seven lampstands, the seven churches, the seven stars is angelos. Angelos can be either angel or messenger. So just so you know, the seven lampstands are the seven churches, and the seven angels are, or angelos or messengers, are those who are delivering this letter specifically to this church. Second, church in Smyrna. This church is one of the two churches that have no rebuke. Smyrna sounds like myrrh, and there's a reason for it. Because Smyrna was home to, at least nationally, established around the Holy Roman Empire, they were known for their myrrh. Now, myrrh should be a familiar theme. You'll know that myrrh was one of the gifts that was presented to Jesus Christ by the Medes as a form of worship. But myrrh, it's interesting. Myrrh was more like a bark or a root, and it was crushed. It had to be crushed. So myrrh was crushed, and then as it was crushed, the liquid fragrance was collected. Also, you'll know, myrrh was also used to embalm the dead, but just as a side note, how ironic is it that God allowed Satan to crush this church so that their aroma, the myrrh of them, would come out? Just as a little bit of context, there was a mandated decree by Caesar prior to this, in which Caesar required an altar to be built to him. Part of this is once a year residents from around the Holy Roman Empire, okay, in every major city there would be an idol erected of Caesar, where once a year the people had to come and offer sacrifices and incense to Caesar, because Caesar claimed to be God, not the only God, but one God of many. And so as the people came and offered sacrifices, they were given a certificate. This certificate allowed them to practice whatever religion they wanted. And so here you're stuck in a kind of a difficult place here. I'm sure you can rationalize it a little bit. All offer worship to the government so I can worship. And so what happened? Well, some Christians refused. Their assets were seized, property was taken from them. They were beaten. They were imprisoned. Some of them were even burned alive. We're going to take a look at Polycarp in a little bit. He was the pastor of Smyrna. So there were false Judaizers in the church that had even blamed and accused Christians of cannibalism. Additionally, we read it repeatedly in many of Paul's letters. What does he say to the brothers? He says, greet each brother with a holy kiss. Well, people were twisting that around and saying, this is homosexual activity. And so there were these false Judaizers, there were these those who adhere to false religion that were saying, hey, listen, the very thing they say not to do, they're actually doing themselves. They were kind of reading it out of context. They were false Jews because, as already said, the only true Jew is that who is circumcised in the heart. And then we'll see also in Smyrna, you'll see in verse 9, chapter 2, verse 9, I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you're rich. And the slander of those who say that they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Polycarp, as many of you guys know, was killed in the mid-second century. He was summoned to the arena of Rome in front of a proconsul because he refused to offer this type of worship to Caesar. The spot was blown up, especially by these false Judaizers, and he was brought before Caesar in Rome, and they said, look, just recant, make sacrifice to Caesar, or you'll be killed. And this is what he says, and I quote, 86 years have I served him, and he has done me no wrong. How can I blaspheme my king who saved me? The proconsul threatened him with burning. Polycarp says, you threaten me with the fire that burns for a time and is quickly quenched? For you do not know the fire which awaits the wicked in the judgment to come and in everlasting punishment. While you're waiting, come, do what you will. They were going to bind him at the stake. Maybe he would be a little bit restless. And he says, leave me as I am. He said, for he who gives me power to endure the fire will grant me to remain in the flames unmoved, even without the security of your binding. End quote. So he says, poverty. He says, I know your poverty. They had nothing. Listen, their property was confiscated. They were arrested. They weren't able to keep anything that they had worked for because they chose not to offer sacrifices to Caesar. Mm-hmm. Oh, they were physically poor, but they were rich spiritually. You know, I think it was already mentioned that persecution cleanses the church. Vance Havner once said, the reason why the church isn't persecuted by the world is because there's nothing to persecute. The church is the world. And so this church had been cleansed from all of their phonies, all of the fake professed Christians, but only those who were of Jesus Christ remained. Be faithful. And I want to let you know that if you are ever ashamed of Jesus Christ, he will be ashamed of you. And you have much more to be ashamed of than he does. Third, the church in Pergamum. Pergamum literally means parchment. It's about 20 miles from inland from the Aegean Sea. It literally means parchment. In verse 12, Jesus Christ says, to the angel of the church in Pergamum write the words of him who has sharp two-edged sword. It says judgment that moves side to side. Now, apparently, Pergamum has quite a history. Apparently, they had one of the largest libraries in the Roman Empire, over 250,000 volumes. Now, listen, there's no Johannes Gutenberg around at this time, if you guys know who I'm talking about, okay? He's the one that developed the printing press, okay? He's not even alive. No one even thought about him, okay? People received copies because they hand wrote it. Listen, there's a library in here that had 250,000, listen, not books, volumes of books. This church was a sister church of Ephesus. Read this in chapters 16 through 19 in Acts. Now it's interesting because in verse 13 he says, I know where you dwell, where Satan's throne is. Something I found interesting is that there was another shrine here. It was the god of Asclepius, A-S-C-L-E-P-I-U-S. This was the god of healing, okay? And apparently there was a shrine in Pergamum where people who were sick would come in the shrine, lay down, and in the shrine there were non-venomous snakes. And if a non-venomous snake touched you, you would be healed. And the crazy thing about it is, people were. This was demonic healing. And just as a side note, our medical symbol today has two winged staff with what wrapped around it?
Snake.
Oh, ironic. We'll leave it at that. Affirmation. They didn't deny the faith. See in verse 13, you hold fast my name and you did not deny my faith, even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness who was killed among you. Apparently, there was a leader in the church. He may have been an elder, a pastor. His name was Antipas, but apparently there was a brass bowl. It was actually one of a pagan god, a shrine. Apparently, they hollowed the brass bowl out, put Antipas in it, and set a fire under it. So he was literally cooked and burned to death, which may even be a worse kind of death than being burned alive. People witnessed this. People saw this happen. They saw what happened to him, and they still held the faith. Verse 14. This is the appeal. But I have a few things against you. You have some there who told the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the sons of Israel so that they might eat food, sacrifice to idols, and practice sexual immorality. We're not going to turn to it, but in Numbers chapter 22 through 25, some of you are familiar, Balak was the king of Moab. Well, he didn't really like Israel too much, and he wanted to eliminate them, so he paid for a prophet, his name was Balaam, to curse Israel. But only blessings came from his mouth, and this happened time after time, and so he thought, okay, hold on a second, let me think about this. If I can't get a prophet to curse Israel, maybe I can get them to intermarry with the pagans. Compromise their devotion, make them unequally yoked. And so when that didn't work, Balak had the Moabite women, who apparently were very attractive, seduce the Israelites. Marry them, adopt their customs, their idols, their false gods. They were intermarrying with the world. And so, what does this mean for you? There was rampant sin in Pergamum. James 4:4, friendship with the world is enmity towards God. Now listen, the church at Pergamum wanted both Christ and the world. The church compromised. The church knew, the leaders knew that there was sin going on in their church, and they did nothing about it. So what will happen if there's no repentance? I'll tell you what happened. You'll hear people say, Satan has that church. Not on all occasions. Jesus Christ will destroy that church before he'll ever let him rule it. And that's exactly what he did to the church in Pergamum. Jesus Christ, if you do not repent, will destroy your church. And so I ask you that question. If you are part of a local congregation, is there sin going on that is unconfessed and void of repentance? You know, as I was thinking of this word repentance, it takes me to Matthew chapter 3. You know, as John the Baptist was doing his thing in the wilderness, first word out of his mouth was repent, right? Okay. And then Jesus in Matthew chapter 4, his first word in his public ministry was repent. And so I ask you that question as well. Is that a theme at your local congregation? Is there a regular call to repentance? Sure. It didn't happen at this church. But I love this. He says, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Hey, he's saying the same thing to them and the same thing to you and me. Here, check out what he's got to say to this church in Pergamum. He's got the same thing to say to you as well. And I love this. To the one who conquers, I will give him some of the hidden manna. Now, this takes us obviously back to the Exodus. The children of Israel are wandering in the desert. And what do they have to eat? Not fish, not cucumbers, not melons, but this manna. This manna. But we're not going to turn to it. But in Exodus chapter 16, verse 33, manna was actually placed inside of the ark. Jesus Christ is the bread or manna of life. Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Jesus Christ as the hidden manna is now given to all of those who are hungry and thirsty and who are needy. And a white stone. Not only during Olympic Games did you receive a crown, but the winner received a white stone. On that white stone, the winner's name would be written on it. And at the end of every Olympic trial, there would be a feast. But guess what? You need a ticket to get into that feast. Well, the only ones who conquer will receive that white stone. And that's the same thing with you and I. Those who persevere to the end will receive their white stone, not to a ticket of temporal food, but at the marriage supper of the Lamb with Jesus Christ. Then we turn to the church in Thyatira, chapter 2, verse 18. To the angel or messenger of the church in Thyatira, write the words of the Son of God, who has eyes like a flame of fire and whose feet are like burnished bronze. This is similar to chapter 1, verse 14. The hairs of his head were white, like white wool, like snow. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were like burnished bronze. His eyes are like fire. Well, as we already saw, fire has cleansing purposes, but what radiates from a fire? Light. So this isn't just cleansing properties. It is Jesus Christ walking among the golden lampstands and saying, you may have other people fooled, but I see you with my eyes of flame and fire and light. Now, the church in Thyatira, if I had a spectrum, was the opposite of Ephesus, okay? So Ephesus was doctrinally sound. They got that heritage. They got their Bible memorized, even in languages that isn't even written yet, okay? So they have that all squared away, but this church in Thyatira was the opposite, which I fear is a lot of churches, in particular, around the area. And I want to challenge you to this. This, I think, is going to be one of the hardest hitting churches for you, and I want to challenge you to it. Let's take a look at this. So they had a labor of love. Love, love, love. They're a popular church. Listen, they are well-known. People like them. And this woman, Jezebel, is mentioned. We'll get to it later. They tolerate her. Now, this is similar to Pergamum. This is similar to Pergamum, but except there's more toleration. Like the kind of toleration that we just saw earlier in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, when a son is sleeping with his mother and the people are rejoicing about it. That type of rampant sin. Now, what was worse was that Christians were attending idol feasts. Okay, see this in 1 Corinthians 10:21. Paul says, you cannot drink the cup of the Lord and the cup of demons. You cannot partake of the table of the Lord and the table of demons. Listen, this woman, she could have been a literal woman. We don't really think that's literally her name. We're going to take a look at the Old Testament, Jezebel. But apparently this woman or this teacher was leading other Christians astray, in particular to sexual sins, okay? These types of sins would occur during idol feasts. There would be massive sexual orgies. It's just nasty stuff. But what was worse, was that Christians were causing other Christians to stumble. Now, about a year ago, I went out to eat with a dearly beloved brother of mine. Okay, we went to Applebee's, and there was a long wait, and there were two chairs open. It was at the bar. And so I didn't feel comfortable sitting and eating at the bar. Why? People could see something they didn't see or make something they didn't see. Maybe people will be talking. Maybe people will make things up. I was not comfortable. And he said to me, oh, what's the big deal? I'm with you. They got anything, I'm your witness. So what do you think we wound up doing? We wound up waiting. I had a more sensitive conscience. He would have caused me to feel uncomfortable, although he was right with what he said. He would have made me feel uncomfortable if we would have done that. Now, some of you are saying, I don't care, I just would have sat there, right? But he would have caused me to stumble if I would have went there. And unfortunately, this is what this woman Jezebel was doing to other Christians. Jesus tells you in Matthew chapter 18, verse 6, whoever causes these little ones to sin, it would be greater, it would be better, it would be more profitable to them to have a large millstone wrapped around their neck to be drowned in the sea. Jesus is telling this church that this woman, you not only tolerate her, but you're embracing her, who's causing other Christians, new believers, to sin. You can check Jezebel out in 1 Kings chapter 16 and then in 2 Kings chapter 9. 1 Kings 16, 2 Kings 9. This woman also may have been a leader. She may have taught dualism, okay? Dualism was spirit is good, flesh is bad. Or she may have been teaching antinomianism. Do what you want so grace may abound. I'll tell you what, if you really love someone, you're not going to do anything to upset them. And if you do upset them and you love them, you will be first, eventually, to apologize and ask for forgiveness. But she was teaching a different doctrine. So what happened to Jezebel? Short story. She She was thrown off a wall. Horses trampled her body. Dogs ate her flesh. They went and told people. They came back out. They couldn't find her. And they said, well, dogs ate her. Graphic. Now, this is not a time for gifts of the Spirit, but we'll see. Apparently, she is a prophetess. Verse 20. You tolerate this woman, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess. Not only is she a woman teaching, but she is a woman teaching damning heresy. And you tolerate her. So what's going to happen? Well, Jesus gave her time to what?
Repent.
To repent. So what's he going to do? He's going to throw her on a sickbed. This can either have two interpretations or they can both be the same. The sickbed can either be the byproducts or the results of a promiscuous life. The diseases that accompany those who do not stay pure happens. Or the sickbed can also mean hell and eternal damnation. That is a sickbed that you will be sick forever. And so what does this mean to you? This has a similar theme of Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1 focuses on the same-sex side. This focuses on the heterosexual side. Both have implications. So what does it mean for you? We have a lot of teachers in here. So if you're a teacher, you better be speaking the truth. You better be faithful with the entrustment. If there's false teaching in your church, you better address the issue. And if you as a Christian, if you are using your liberty to sin, and as a result you're causing others who are weaker in the faith to sin, let me put it a different way. It'd be better off for you not to be born. So you need to be aware of that. He says, I will give you according to your deeds. Now, if you want that lifestyle, you can have it. If you want to bind yourself to a harlot, you can have it. But you will receive, if you do not repent, the wages of your sin. There's only two types of economy. There's God's pay, that you may not get till the next life. And there's the wages of the world's pay. I'm still waiting for my inheritance. And I love this. Only, verse 25, only hold fast what you have till I come. The one who conquers and who keeps my works until the end, to him I will give authority over the nations. And what happens? I will give him, verse 28, the morning star. What is the morning star? Turn to Revelation chapter 22. We'll show you who the morning star is. Revelation chapter 22, verse 16. I, Jesus, have sent my angels to testify to you about the things of the churches. I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. Listen, if you stand faithful to the end, you get Jesus. You get the bright morning star. You get him. Next is the church in Sardis. The angel of the church in Sardis, the words of him who has the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. This has tripped some people up. In your spare time, you can turn. We don't have the time, but you could turn to Isaiah chapter 11, verses 2 through 3. It's not that God has three spirits. God is one spirit, but he manifests himself in certain ways. I'll read it to you. The sevenfold spirit is the spirit of wisdom, of understanding, counsel, might, knowledge, fear of the Lord, and the spirit of the Lord. So these are all manifestations of it. That's the seven, literally seven, okay? And so you can turn to Isaiah chapter 11 for that. So in terms of their affirmation, this is the church in Sardis. I know your works. You have the reputation of being alive, but you're dead. Wake up and strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have not found your works complete in the sight of my God. And here it is in verse 4. Yet you still have a few names in Sardis, people who had not soiled their garments and will walk with me in white. There are a few people who did not soil their garments. This is in reference to pagan worship, spiritual slumber, laziness. He's saying this. There are some people in your church that are on fire for Jesus. There's a few. Most of them are dead. They think they're alive. They got a lot of programs going around. They're real active in the community. They seem alive, but listen, I got eyes like fire. I have the light. They're really dead. They're walking in purity now, and I will complete that in the next life. And here's the appeal. They have a reputation. They're known. They're active. They're organized, but they're dead. Now, something I found really interesting is that in most pagan shrines, the people coming in were not allowed to come in their normal clothes. They actually had to change their clothes to clean clothes. Jude 23, Jude tells us we're to have garments without spot of the flesh. And the reality is that they were void of the spirit, but they were very active. In your spare time, if you want to read a really long poem, but rich, is a poem by Samuel Taylor Coleridge. It's called The Rime of the Ancient Mariner. This is what he says. I just took a small snippet. Corpses man the ship. Dead men pull the oars. Dead men hoist the sails. Dead men steer the vessel. The congregation of Sardis was the reverse of Smyrna. Smyrna was smashed and put to death so that only their aroma of sacrifice remains. Yet Sardis appeared alive. It was dead. They seemed to be going through the motions. No spiritual life. So what does this mean to you? A question for you. What is your church's reputation? Are you known in the community for your shows, for your festivals, for your outreaches? Why do you have outreaches? Your building may be full, but as we just saw in Samuel Taylor Coleridge's famous poem, it may be full of dead people. Is God active and moving in your congregation? Are people not only confessing, but possessing Christ? Is there continual repentance in your local fellowship? If there's not, better leave. Or you call them to repentance. Now we find something interesting here in verse 5. The one who conquers will be clothed thus in white garments, and I will never blot his name out of the book of life. Wait a second. If thoughts, our names were written on the palm of his hands. I thought that no names were ever erased out of the book of life. Well, there's two correct interpretations of this. First is the book of life. Moses had a book of life. Actually, as a matter of fact, every civilization would have a book of life. It was a book of the living. It essentially was an accurate record of the people within a tribe. How do you think the tribes were able to be numbered down to their very specifics? Because there was an accurate record of it. And Jesus is saying this: if you are faithful to me, I will not take your life prematurely as I did towards Ananias and Sapphira. Okay? This book of life refers to a premature death. Yes, God is sovereign, but you could rob yourself of days in this life. You are responsible. So that's the first. The second is, I will never blot his name out of the book of life. That's right, because Jesus tells us later, which we'll see, and his name will never be erased out of the book of life. So Jesus is just reaffirming, hey, I'm not going to blot your name out of the book of life, if that's literal, those who were written before the foundations of the earth, or literal, hey, you're not going to have an untimely death. Both are equally valid. And this, I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. You know, we do have an advocate, as a brother earlier was saying, Satan always walking to and fro the earth, Jesus always whispering to the Father, hey, see Greg? He says he's a Christian, right? Well, look what he did. Here we see, he will confess me before my Father. Jesus will say, I paid for that. I paid for that. He's with me. He's with me. Not only is Jesus Christ our lawyer, not only is he our advocate, but he has been the one who has purchased our salvation. And those who God saves, he keeps to the end, because nobody can snatch them out of my hand. I and the Father are one. So, church in Philadelphia, affirmation. I love this. They had little power. Little dynamite. I like to call them the concentrated church. Concentrated, a lot of power packed in a few people. This church was about 30 miles southeast of Sardis. They were marked by obedience. This obedience will even, which we'll see, lead to even the synagogue of Satan bowing at their feet, either at this life or the life to come. I want to look at verse 8. I know your works. Of course you know it. You have the all-seeing eye. Behold, I have set before you an open door which no one is able to shut. I know you have but little power, yet you have kept my words and have not denied my name. Behold, I make those of the synagogue of Satan who say that they are Jews and are not, but lie. Behold, I will make them come and bow down before your feet. Now, a lot of people use this verse incorrectly. Okay? Yes, there is an open door that nobody can shut. But the question we need to ask is, what is the open door from? For the open door, listen, is for those who are the synagogue of Satan to come down and bow at their feet. So check it out, right? These other churches have all these pomp, all these celebrations, all of this going on. They're dead. But here, this church in Philadelphia has a few. They're small in number. They're powerful. But check it out. The door that's going to be open is either going to be used for persecution, being a way it means to draw those who are in pagan worship to bow at their feet, or it can even be in light of missions as well. So I ask you, how is your church with missions? Are you regularly, do you even know who your missionaries are? Does your congregation know who they are and where they're serving? This open door is most likely for missionary work. Saying, hey, you got a few, we're going to send you, and the gospel is going to be effective. And people will repent, sinners will return. So what does this mean to you? Listen, the size of your church does not determine the far-reaching effect of your ministry. Philadelphia was most likely the smallest church, yet it receives the highest commendation. You have little power, but you will be blessed. He has the key of David. David was a king. He has the authority, the dominion, the power, the king, that a king would ever have. And lastly, I know we're running out of time, Laodicea. Some churches make Jesus angry. This church made him sick. Generally, in most churches, local believers, you have only two types of people. You have people who are on fire for God, and you have those who have grown cold. But there were none of these in the Laodicea church. They're religious, but they're apostate. They think they're strong, but they're weak. Just as a side note, the church in Laodicea actually had one of the most opulent banking institutions in all of the Roman Empire. They were known for their black wool. Jesus here saying in verse 18, I counsel you to buy for me what? Gold. Refined by fire so that you could be rich. You may have all the banks in the world, in all the Roman Empire, but you're poor. And white garments. You know what? They produce black wool. Symbolic of the reality of their spiritual condition. And Jesus is saying, I'll give you white garments. And also, I'll give you salve to anoint your eyes. Apparently, as well, they produce some type of eye drop to remedy the abuses of the climate in the Middle East. Now, there may not have even been a single believer in this church. Earlier, I prayed for my brother Kyle. People who went in Laodicea were rich, and they were well off, and they had no need, no physical need. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. I love this. It says in verse 19, those who I love I reprove and discipline, so be zealous and repent. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. I love it if anyone hears, open up. I will come and eat with him and he with me. And so, what's going on here at this church? What does this mean to you? In my opinion, this is the most frightful condition for a church, right? So, the saving verse in my life that saved me as a junior was in Matthew 7:23, right? People come to him, and the last days are going to say, I've done all these things. He's going to say, I never knew you, right? So check it out, ready? These people are actually doing things, right? Their works are never sufficient to save, but they're basing their salvation and kingdom work on themselves. And Jesus said, you didn't do it all. I never knew you. We're never like husband and wife. We were never intimate. You had ulterior motives for why you did these things. But hey, at least they're a little hot, right? These are a little hot. And so if Jesus says to the people who are a little hot, I never knew you, what's he going to say to the people who are lukewarm? Now, check it out. Ready? Nothing comes or nourishes your body unless it comes through the mouth. Jesus is the head of the body, that is the church. Jesus is verbally eating this, tasting this church. He's throwing them on. Maybe even part of it reaches his stomach. But we are all members of the body of Christ, and even believers will throw them up and throw them out. And so either one, so I ask you this question. Does your church teach the full counsel of God? Is your church marked by repentance? And do the people know what they need to repent from? I only want to spend a couple of minutes here going over eschatology, and then we'll be done. There are three main positions towards eschatology. Eschatology just means the end times, the end, okay? This is, just to let you know, in terms of a list of top priority, middle priority things I'm flexible with, you, as a believer, you, and even as a pastor, you need to embrace and determine what is a non-negotiable for you. For example, in our church, in our leadership, not everybody takes a particular, the same eschatological position that I do in terms of eschatology, but that's, I guess that's okay, right? So you, as a believer, you need to know where you stand and why you stand. So first is amillennial. A is without. Whenever you see a before a word, generally it means without. Amillennial, millennium, without the millennium, okay? This is in light of Revelation chapter 20. So those who take a position towards amillennial say that there will be no millennium. The 1,000 years is figurative, not literal. And I provided for you on there a map, okay? You can find the map. It's the first map. It's labeled a millennial chart. I hope you can't miss it. So there will be no millennium, no physical earthly, everything is spiritual, no physical earthly reign of Christ. And the great and final judgment will immediately follow the second coming of Jesus Christ, okay? Now, when dealing with Revelation chapter 20, they just have the whole book in mind, but yet they seem to be selective in what they want to take literal. So, for example, if you were to ask someone who's amillennial, who would hold that as being literal, is this literally a revelation? Are there literally seven churches? Is this everything that we've just looked at? What is literal and what's not? And eventually, you become your own interpreter of the book of Revelation. And I would just like to challenge you to say, if you believe that the 1,000 years is figurative, where in the text, point, don't answer it, but where in the text, where in the text, points to it, okay? Mm-hmm. Now, the church, According to this position, the church age will continue. We are in the church age. There will be a resurrection of both believers and unbelievers. There's the bema of Christ. We'll get to that later. Unbelievers will be raised to final judgment. Bottom line, all the end events happen at once. We're in the church age, okay? There's no literal millennium. It's all figurative. Jesus Christ will come back. Everything will happen very quickly. There is no seven of anything. Everything's, most things are literal. And so following that will be a literal judgment, okay? Now, Benjamin Warfield, I have to write this down. I have to. I got so excited when I saw that. Okay, great. So Benjamin Warfield, he's actually someone who I look up to just in terms of as a student of Scripture, but I completely disagree with what he says. So this is what he says, right? So he says, this is how they come up with 10,000, right? You take the holy number of seven, right?
Oh my gosh.
Ready? Hold on. We're not done. Now, you add three because there's a trinity.
Come on, no way.
Now, you're at 10. Now, you cube 10 three times because, again, there's a trinity. So, 10 times 10 times 10 is 1,000. That's why. This is what he says, and I quote. In his book, The Millennium and the Apocalypse, says, the sacred number 7 in combination with the equally sacred number 3 forms the number of holy perfection, 10. And when the 10 is cubed into 1,000, the seer has said all he could to convey our minds the idea about absolute completeness. And one other thing as a side note, what happens to Israel? Israel was the people of God. And now the church has replaced Israel. There is no future for Israel. Israel was not a one and done, but a many and done. Now the church is the new Israel. Postmillennialism, very similar to amillennial. Post means after. Jesus Christ will return after the millennium. This is a progressive approach. Now, unlike the amillennial position, there is a literal earthly bodily reign of Christ physically. And so in order for Jesus Christ to reign here on this earth, you have to take a literal interpretation of some Old Testament quotes. We're not going to examine them today. You can check it out in your spare time. But what you'll find out is that in the book of Revelation, Old Testament verses that are quoted are those abstract. So now you go back to the Old Testament. Now you have the minor and major prophets prophesying, but that's not literal. So that's something for you guys to consider. Christian influences, according to the postmillennial, is that society will gradually increase and there will be a millennium of peace and righteousness, although it's not a literal 1,000 years. The church, the growth of the church will continue, and the gospel will be so successful that the world will be converted. Bottom line, very optimistic about the spread of the gospel to change lives. They hold that that Satan, we'll take a look at this, in Revelation chapter 19 and 20, Satan is bound and loose for 1,000 years, not a literal 1,000 years, we have to remember that, okay, but he was bound for a time. This is following Christ's ascension. So obviously Satan has to be bound because who's going to deceive the nations? Obviously Satan has to be bound because the gospel has to go forth. So they are very optimistic. Now there's something called the 1040 window. Has anybody heard of the 1040 window before? Good. The 1040 window is 10 degrees north, it's between 10 degrees north of the equator and 40 degrees north of the equator. Okay, you can check out a map. I was going to include, but I didn't. But it has a population of 2.4 billion people. Now, of the 7 billion people on this earth, around 1.7 billion people have never been exposed to the gospel and have no access to it. What's even worse, of the 50 least evangelized countries in the 1040 window, 37 of them are in the 1040 window. Now, what do I want you to walk away with? It's this. How what percent of total missionaries, if there were 100 missionaries right now on the globe, how many of them do you think would be in the 10, 40 window? Eight. People just don't want to go there. It's hostile. Eight missionaries. Eight, that's it. 8% of total missionaries are serving in between the 10-40 window. Lastly, pre-trib, premillennial, dispensational premillennialism. Christ will return before the great, and my suggestion to you would be to look at the map. I provided for you guys a chart. I'm so glad I'm going last. So, let me walk you through it. This is a progressive dispensationalist looks at God's redemptive plan as being epochs, okay? Not epoxy, okay? Epochs, or seasons, or time frames. So, let me walk you through it. Right now, we're in the church age. According to a premillennial dispensationalist, at some point in the future, there will be something called the rapture. This rapture is not the second coming, okay? The rapture is seen in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, where believers are caught up in the air. Those between Christ's death, burial, and resurrection, those who didn't pop out of the grave, which we'll get to in a second, those who have died in Christ will rise first, and then in a twinkling of an eye, those who are alive will be caught up in the air. Now, some people translate it blink of an eye. Blink of an eye is too long. It actually refers to how fast light is retracted off of the pupil. So blinking is too long, okay? So those who are in the grave from Christ until the rapture are first, and then right after that are going to be those who are caught up. Blinking's too long. It's light refracting off of the lens of the eye, okay? So then ushers in a literal 7 years tribulation. First 3.5 years are going to be a time of peace and prosperity. The second 3.5 years is going to be judgment, as God's judgment is being poured out on mankind. Now, I want us to turn a chapter 7, Revelation chapter 6. Revelation chapter 6. You guys can look at the map later on. I'll open up the floor to questions if you have anything afterwards, but I want to look at a literal interpretation of Revelation chapter 6. I only want to mention a couple of things. I watched the Lamb open one of the seven seals, and I heard one like the four living creatures say with a voice like thunder. Thunder in Scripture is always attributed to what? Voice of God and judgment. So it's come, and I looked, and behold, a white horse. White is the symbol of what? Peace. Or purity, or peace. And its rider had a bow in a crown. What goes with a bow? What is it missing? An arrow. A bow without an arrow is peace. And yet a crown was given to him, and he came out conquering. When he opened the second seal, second living creature said, come, and out came another horse, bright red. Red is symbolic for war. The rider was permitted to take peace from the earth, and so people will slay one another. Verse 5, there's a third seal, there's a black horse, this is famine. Now this is really interesting. Now if you take this literal, now scales are generally always used or referred to in the Old Testament as weighing in of food, okay? And so what you have is you have a rider having a pair of scales in his hand, which means that after this third seal, there's going to be rationing. There's going to be famine in the land. And a voice said, a quart of wheat for a denarius. One person, so a denarius is one day laborer's wage. So a quart of wheat is what one person consumes in one day. And so what this is saying is that there's going to be a ration of food, there's going to be starvation, and that if you have a family that's larger than one, you're going to have to cut back on things that are needful. Three quarts of barley. Barley was used primarily to feed animals and pigs. Barley, in terms of nutritional value, is considerably less nutritional, but there's more of it. Do not harm the oil and the wine. Oil and wine is used for cooking. And then you have a pale horse coming in. And verse 8, the rider's name was Death. A quarter of the earth was killed with the sword and famine and pestilence by wild beasts of the earth. Some people are saying, wait a second, how can pestilence or how can wild beasts kill one-fourth of the earth? It actually happened a total within 200 years. It actually happened 7 times in Europe. What happened?
Black plague.
Black plague killed somewhere between a quarter to third of the population in Europe. And so there's nothing to prevent something similar like that from happening. Fifth seal, there are martyrs. They cried out, how long? And listen, this is where I see the sovereignty of God here. Verse 11, they were each given a white robe and told to rest a little longer until the number of their fellow servants and their brothers should be complete, who were to be killed as they themselves have been. God has a plan. God has a design, not only in the death of Christians, but also in your sufferings in your life as well. Jesus is saying, I'm not coming back. I'm not acting until all of those who are supposed to be martyred are martyred. So, and by the way, if you have a problem with that, I want to ask you, what would happen if Jesus came back one day before you were saved? You would be damned. And so praise God, he is patient. Praise God, he didn't come back when I was 15 years old and rebellious. And those of you guys who were saved at a later age, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You have experienced grace and mercy in a manner that those who were saved at a younger age were spared from. But there's a unique approach towards those who are in rebellion that now have towards the patience and the mercy of God. Praise God he didn't come back while I was still in rebellion. And praise God he didn't come back while you were in rebellion as well. So, final judgment and rewards. I want to turn to Revelation chapter 20 and then we're done. There's just so much to say. I don't know whether I'm being rude. I don't know whether you're being kind, but if you guys need to leave, you guys feel free to leave. There's just certain things I cannot skip over. So final judgments are reward. Okay, if you are a non-believer in here, I'm going to tell you whether or not you believe there is a final judgment is irrelevant because there is. Okay. Now some of you will say there's no way to prove it. There's no way to prove that. That's like saying I'm not going to die because I haven't died yet. It has the same concept. Just because it hasn't happened yet doesn't mean that it's not going to, and you will find out sooner or later. So, final judgments and rewards. Jesus Christ will be the judge. You guys can check that out in your own time in your scripture references. Unbelievers will be judged, Revelation chapter 20, verse 12. And I saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne, and the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged by what was written in the books according to what they had done. The sea gave up the dead, death and Hades gave up, and all of them were thrown in the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. Unbelievers will be judged, and believers will be judged as well. However, Jesus Christ has already paid our penalty. And so now we can say there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. However, you will be rewarded. What type of reward? We're not going to turn to it, but in 1 Corinthians chapter 4, it's known as the Bema seat of Christ, where everything that I've done for Jesus will be tested by his omniscience. So for example, if the reason why I'm doing this is to show you anything about me, I would have robbed myself from eternal rewards. And so just because we are active, God is examining our hearts. I might say, hey, I did that for you. He said, no, you didn't. You did that for yourself. And this is not being credited to your eternal reward. And so when you say, to God be the glory, my prayer, and I hope yours is that would truly be the reality of our heart. And so that's why I come to you with humility and just saying that I want this to be for God's renown, his glory, his worth, for you to see him as he is, but also to know that you will receive your reward. You will be rewarded in this next life, even if you spend all your life in prison in this. Angels will be judged. Paul had a problem in the Corinth church. Believers were suing one another. He says, can't you settle things among yourself? Don't you know that we are to judge angels? Which angels are we judging? Those, the third of the angels that were cast out of heaven during the rebellion. Okay, you can read about that in Isaiah chapter 14. Number 6, the final judgment will satisfy our deepest desires and ultimate rewards. I had some questions or some side observations that I had in terms of me working out the order of events, and so we'll save that, but I want to say this. If you are a non-believer in here, in this sitting down right now, if you're a non-believer, this will be the only age of mercy and grace. Okay. Let me tell you, grace is unmerited favor, and mercy is clemency. Okay? Clemency is not receiving what you deserve. Listen, this life, while you have breath, will be the only age that you receive the unmerited favor of God, of breathing as a rebel, and also for mercy and God not destroying you right now. And so this is the time to repent. And look at the invitation, Revelation 22:17. The Spirit and the Bride say, come, and let the one who hears say, come, and let the one who is thirsty come, let the one who desires take the water of life without price. Creation, fall, redemption, consummation. The heavens are not clean in God's sight. He is doing away with it, and he is creating all things new. And something I want to leave with is this. This is so cool. In heaven, you'll never have to watch what you say because you'll never be able to say anything that's sinful or offensive. You'll never, ever have to apologize for anything because you'll have nothing to apologize for. You'll never have to clarify anything because nothing will ever need to be clarified because you will be known for who you are and they will be known for who they are. Everything that you say will be right and perfect because sin and Satan and devil, all of that will be destroyed and Jesus Christ will be victorious. And So the Spirit says to the bride, come. If you're thirsty, come to him who is the living water.